So we're very excited to have Jeanette LeBlanc join us for our Alumni Career Chat series today. Jeanette is joined today by members of the Center for Career Development team, myself, Tegan O'Connor, Employer Relations Coordinator, and my colleagues, Manching Tom, who is our Assistant Director for Student Employment, and Olivia Marriott, who is our Office Coordinator. So Jeanette graduated from Manhattanville in 2012 with a degree in business management, and she is currently working as a brand strategy consultant for Halls and Partners. And she was very involved during her time at Manhattanville with a number of different departments, associations, and clubs on campus, including Residence Life, the Castle Scholars Program, Clark Center, formerly the Duchesne Center, and she also worked on campus as an ePortfolio supervisor and marketing department intern. So thank you so much, Jeanette, for taking the time to speak with us today.
Thanks for having me.
So my first question is, could you take a moment to just describe your current position as a brand strategy consultant and sort of what motivates you right now to stay in your current role?
Definitely. So a brand strategy consultant is somebody who just helps brands solve any types of questions that they might have about the state of their current business, or even more excitingly, when we get these projects, the state of what they want their future business to look like. And so for the company that I work at, Hall & Partners, it is a research company. And so predominantly they're known for quantitative research, but I do qualitative research, which is so much fun and I absolutely love it. And it's really just talking to people. So normally I'm traveling, talking to people in person, but right now my day looks a lot like this Teams meeting because I'm talking to people through video chat. And so it's great because I get to ask a lot of different people a lot of different questions about what is important to them. And then on the back end, we help brands figure out how that authentically fits in with whatever it is that their objectives happen to be. So current state, future state, or something else.
That's wonderful. Where are you traveling mostly? I mean, I know right now you're home, but where have you been able to travel to?
Oh my gosh, it's been so exciting. I've done a lot of domestic travel over the years, but prior to the quarantine, it was a lot of international travel. So I've been to Mexico, the UK, I've been to India, I've been to China.
Wow.
Gosh, a bunch of other places too. And so it's been really great in terms of just opening my eyes to the whole world. A lot of clients have said, because we've just recently convinced them that traveling is really important. And the first time, Japan is one of the places we've been to. The first really big international trip, I think, that I had taken was to Japan with a client. And the client had said to me, we didn't even need, he was, you know, joking, but he was like, we didn't even need to sit through the research, like the context and the immersion that I got from being here for a week. He was like, was extraordinary. And he was like, we absolutely have to do this for every project. And so we had been, and so, you know, I'm looking forward to getting back to that, of course, when things are safer, but you know, it's so cool to talk to people over video chat, which is a methodology we do also use in combination typically with in-person, but it's cool because you get to see a really intimate view of people's lives in terms of how they're either living at home, if we're talking with consumers, or if we're talking, you know, to people in a B2B space, you know, their office. And it's pretty cool because they just let interruptions happen, which is just interesting context. So you'll see them be like, oh, hold on, and they'll answer, you know, a business call, and you'll hear that exchange, or you know, you'll see like the people who are coming into the room, or you know, them handing off something. And I was just reading a transcript from one of our interviews the other day. I was doing the analysis and I was laughing. There was this point when, you know, this woman is just yelling at her cat for a couple of seconds. And I was like, ow, no. And it was this whole just really intimate exchange you wouldn't have gotten otherwise. So I love it. And it's just ultimately talking to people. And, you know, it's something that we obviously do every day in most situations. But I think to have that analytical lens on it is just really eye-opening.
Yeah, that's really interesting. Yeah, it's a totally different aspect of it working, you know, remotely. Jeanette, I'm sure a lot of our students are interested to know, during your time at Manhattanville, what were some of the most defining events or opportunities while you were at Manhattanville?
I think there were so many, but I think residence life for me really helped me find kind of my grounding at Manhattanville. And I was hired my second semester of freshman year. So I was an RA for 3.5 years of my time on campus. And so it was pretty great because they care so much about, you know, the students on campus and just having that additional insight into what really does go on behind the scenes. Like, they're involved in everything. So, you know, all of those activities you had listed that I had done, like, residence life does play a part in each and every one of those in some way, shape, or form. And also the time commitment, I think, was pretty incredible in terms of how willing these people are to go out of their way for people they know, people they don't know, and just really help make their time on campus super valuable in all sorts of different things. And I think that's sort of carried through into, you know, professional life too, and even personal life in terms of how to talk to people, which is obviously something I do every day in my role, and just come from this common place of understanding and, you know, knowing, okay, we all have something in common, let's find what that is, and then explore, you know, what makes us interesting and different. And I think Residence Life really did a good job of bringing Manhattanville's mission, I think, to life. And so I was very lucky to be part of that in multiple residence halls, and there were multiple leaders that came through during that time. Just having that exposure, I think, was really great for me personally. And then I also really enjoyed the Castle Scholar Program. The programs that were within that, I think, were some of my favorite classes that I had taken. One of them that I always talk about is the Religions of New York City. And it was a class that took place on the weekend only, and it was a full day on Saturday. I think it was like 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. And we got in a bus with the professor, Professor Gardella. I think he still teaches.
Yeah, he is. He is still teaching.
He's awesome. That was his class. And so he took us, you know, all day through the city, and we just integrated into different religions and participated and really understood, like, and, you know, let's not just read about it, let's actually participate and watch and learn. And I think that also helped fuel my passion for the role that I have now in qualitative, because it is really anthropological and getting on the ground. And that's why we go to the markets. It's to, you know, see how people are actually doing things, because, you know, and from a research point of view, what people say that they're doing and what they're actually doing is different. And not that they realize that, but it is, to observe what that difference is, I think, is super valuable. And so I certainly learned that from that class. But it also just shows, you know, the depth and breadth of what Manhattanville has to offer, because, you know, that was a totally non-traditional class in terms of, you know, the weekend format and what we were doing and just the entirety of how that class was structured. And so I thought my Cast a Scholar time, and there's many other examples like that through that program, I think was also great. And then I think the marketing department, because that is certainly very much linked to what I'm doing now. And I actually found that role pretty much at the beginning of my freshman year. And I had gone through a series of different bosses, but we had somebody who I admire very, very much. She doesn't work in Manhattanville anymore, but JJ Pryor, who had come in and really helped me understand what a brand is and how to think about that in different aspects. And that's something I do every single day. And so I'm very grateful to her too for, you know, expanding what I was learning in the classroom to real life application. And I think all those examples show how real life application is really important in terms of just having a better understanding.
Awesome. I think you kind of already touched on this question, but how did Manhattanville help prepare you for the career you're in now in brand strategy and market research?
It prepared me in terms of learning how to think. And like I had mentioned, you know, real life application is super, super important, but every single day is different from the last and you're doing something else. And even if there is some sort of repetition, like, you know, something is different. And I think learning how to approach different challenges, you know, with a totally open mindset, and understanding that, you know, the way we've always done things isn't, you know, the way it has to continue to be done, but there's still value in learning, you know, from that history there. So just in terms of the variety of things that I was able to do, both in my activities and also the different types of classes that I was taking that were, you know, within but also very much outside of my major, I think was really important in terms of, you know, how to come at problems from, you know, a mindset that's solution oriented.
Thank you. So you touched on this a little bit too with talking about residence life, but what associations, clubs, or resources at Manhattanville aided you in your sort of professional development?
Yeah, well, definitely, you know, everything I've talked about already. So for sure, residence life, it was one of my first truly professional jobs. I had other little jobs, but that was truly, you know, something that was unlike any position I had held before. And it was also a position of leadership, I think, which is super unique for somebody, you know, so young as college students are. And so, you know, the level of responsibility, I think, was certainly something that has carried through all of my roles. And I think it helped me start out from a place within my career of taking on probably a lot more than somebody entry level normally. And so certainly those organizations that I had mentioned had a significant influence.
Great. What have been the most challenging and what has been the most rewarding moments for you?
I think just figuring it out. So qualitative research wasn't something that I knew anything about during my educational years. It's just something I had fallen into, and it kind of goes back to what I was saying about how Manhattanville prepared me to answer any question that came at me. And certainly, like, what is this qualitative research thing was one of those really big questions that's shaped, you know, who I am today. And so I think very challenging was in my final year at Manhattanville, well, what am I going to do next, right? Like, what is there? And so I had applied for a bunch of full-time positions within, you know, marketing as well as graduate schools, because I was like, okay, well, if I don't get a role, I have to do something, right? So I was like, let me apply to grad school. And it turned out that I ended up getting both. And so I did both at the same time, which was very challenging as well, just in terms of, I think, the time management in terms of, okay, you know, work isn't really 9 to 5, at least not in the industry that I'm in. But, you know, that could, it doesn't mean that it's super extended hours. It can be, but, you know, it's very flexible, which I think is a big pro. So I was able to take that time off to do graduate school. And so that was also very challenging, figuring out that whole thing. But I think being able to make the link between all of the different positions that I've held, they're all similar in terms of the research through line, but really understanding, like, okay, well, how does this connect to this next thing that I want to do? And I think it's something that I still kind of find challenging even today in terms of, like, okay, but what is next? And so recently I've made a switch within the same company, but from working on the consumer side of things. So kind of everyday household things that you might use, it could be credit cards, it could be soft beverages, it could be anything like that, to the healthcare side, which is a much different focus. It's still consumer facing, but very different objectives and outcomes in terms of how to think about things. And so even making the connection between consumer and healthcare and just making sure that it's all telling a story. And I think it's okay. I know it's okay that, you know, if things are totally different, because I think that's what makes a person really valuable, all those different experiences. And so it kind of links back to, you know, countries that I'm going to and the topics that we're discussing and really just being open to those different types of conversations.
And then who would you consider to be your influencer or someone who you really look up to?
I think so. This also goes back to the campus resource question. So somebody that I always continue to talk to is Maureen Kindlin, who's had multiple roles at Manhattanville.
She's great. Yeah.
She great doesn't even begin to describe her, actually. She is just such a well-rounded, well-read, educated, passionate woman. And she was the research librarian during my senior year for my thesis class, the management. And it was the first time I was put into contact with her. And I was always in the library, so I don't know how this is even possible. But, you know, I was introduced to her, and it was just a budding friendship ever since. So she and I and another Manhattanville student will go to dinner, you know, a couple of times a year, and, you know, we'll message or I'll send her mail and stuff like that. But anytime, and it's funny because those dinners typically revolve around like a big decision that I have to make or something that I'm pondering. So every time that, you know, I'm considering taking a new job or, you know, making a career change or, you know, even a personal life decision like purchasing an apartment, I always go back to Maureen, just because, and I think it's sort of been clear from what I've been talking about, but that whole worldly, well-rounded experience. And I think it also goes to show like how powerful the people you have at Manhattanville are. You know, you guys are both graduates of the school. You know, Manching, you've been there for I don't know how long, but you were there when I was
years.
Like the community that's there, I think, is just so strong, and it certainly exists in many ways even after you graduate. But I think it's important to take advantage while you're there as well. And I think that a lot of times it comes on the back end when you're reflecting. But I think that if you can reflect in the moment, there's certainly lots of different opportunities for you to take advantage of. And then lifelong friendships, hopefully.
What is the single most valuable piece of career advice that you've ever received?
Yeah, the single best piece. Well, I think it's just don't be afraid. And my mom had always told me that if somebody asks you to do something, you say, yes, I can do that. And then you figure it out if you can't do it. And clearly, yeah. You know, you're not going to lie too much. I'm like, oh, I know another language and you don't. But you know, I think an exception. And I think I read something, I don't remember where I read it or what the exact figures were, but for women specifically, women don't apply for positions unless they have 100% of the credentials, whereas men, I think it was around 70 to 80% of the credentials a man will apply to a job, and often it's even less. And I think that, you know, says a lot about, you know, at least it speaks to me personally, because I'd rather hand in something, you know, 6 months late than have it, you know, be 1% less of perfection. And, you know, I think don't be afraid to take risks, to take chances, to believe in yourself certainly pays off. And so like, but even within communications, like even within emails, like, be able to make a stand. And, you know, if, as long as you can back up your opinion, you know, make sure your voice is heard. So I think that is really important, particularly for people who are just starting out, who might think that, you know, they don't have the experience, and, you know, that's okay. You know, nobody who's hiring somebody entry level is going to expect you to have experience to back it up. But having that voice will just have more and more people look to you for your opinion, you know, when they're making decisions, and they're more willing to let somebody in who, you know, raises their hand, you know, to make a contribution than somebody who's just observing. So, but, you know, with that said, observing is also very important, particularly when you're starting out. But, you know, to have that mix and to not be afraid to take that next step forward and have that can-do attitude, I think, is definitely something to remember.
It's great to keep in mind. Yeah, it's wonderful. Yeah, right? Jeanette, if a student were to come to you and say, hey, Jeanette, I really wanted to pursue marketing and branding, what would you tell the student are some of the major skills he or she needs to acquire?
Writing is the number one thing. Like the amount of content that I produce on the daily is insane. And that's just in terms of even email communications, Teams, messaging communications, PowerPoint presentations. Like you have to be able to effectively communicate yourself to others in order for brands to then communicate messages out to people. One of the main metrics that we use is clarity. Is it clear? Oftentimes it's not. You know, whether it looks like nothing else makes sense if the message isn't clear. And I think that's important in terms of how you're messaging yourself and your ideas. Am I being clear? Who can understand this? And, you know, it's not important to have things filled with jargon or fancy words or make it clear. And in my personal writing style and communication style is very flowery. And I think it just harks back to my liberal arts, like English, love for reading. And, you know, it just is very detailed. And, you know, that has its place in English literature, but maybe not so much in terms of business communications. And that's okay. But I think just, you know, taking that time to reread things or think about things before you speak them is important for the sake of clarity.
The next question is, what would you recommend to someone who is interested in working in your field? You know, I guess what kind of next steps would you expect them to take? How can they develop themselves? And actually, we do have a student on the call. She has her own blog and she's been doing really great stuff with that, and we're really proud of her. So maybe you even might have advice from a brand standpoint, as she's really been developing her own personal brand. Maybe some advice that you have along with that.
Definitely. I think one of the main research topics that we had spent a lot of time and a lot of the clients' money on was this question about how do people experience experiences? And this was done pre-COVID. And so I'm sure those findings have changed drastically. And we are thinking about what that means. But one of the things we had found, particularly with the Gen Z millennial audience, is that this is the first time that people are their own brands. And that is super, super powerful in terms of just in terms of everything, in terms of how you're presenting yourself to peers, to people in the professional world, and particularly like on a podcast or a blog, you know, just the larger outside world. And so I think it's super important to cultivate that. And it's not something I had ever really thought of, you know, sort of prior to that research piece, which we had done maybe 2 years ago. But it's so true. And I think, you know, to first and foremost know who you are is so important. And right. If you know that at a young age, you know, you're just going to continue to go further and further. And I think it also harkens back to, you know, my advice from earlier, which is don't be afraid to take risk and to change. And it's okay, like, that your personal brand evolves, and it probably should, right? As you have more experiences and you kind of recalibrate what it is that you value and what's important in the context of, you know, where your life stage is or the context of what's happening in the world. You know, it's okay to change and to really be super, super authentic. And so, you know, in terms of next steps, I would say just do a lot of reading. I think there's particular marketing, brand communications, it's so broad and you can do so much. You know, what I do is just one tiny little slice of the pie there. And I think, you know, to really know that your options are quite vast. And, you know, again, don't be afraid to take risks. Like, it's great to have, you know, to kind of jump around. Like, I had started in qualitative research by accident. And then I went to quantitative research, and then I went to academic research, and then I went to digital research. And I was like, no, I really like qualitative research. But I had done that because I was like, well, I don't know if I don't try. And it was sort of the same thing when I made the leap from consumer to health. It's like, well, I don't know. Let's find out. And I had personally thought that I would not like it. It's like, I'm going to think I have every disease in the book. I was like, I was like, this is going to be terrible for me. It's not. I actually absolutely love it and am considering staying on that side of things versus just kind of dabbling in it. So I think, you know, there's a lot out there. And even if you like something, like, well, perhaps there's something you can like even more, you know, but make sure that you're still, you know, you're staying true to that personal brand and what you do next. And I think a lot of my peers are looking for companies that reflect what their personal brand is and are refusing to work for specific clients or for specific types of companies that don't align with who they are. And I think that in terms of your next steps, it's not only like, okay, well, here's all the lists, here's all the job descriptions that I feel like would fit me. Let's just apply to all and take the first one that comes along. I think that the job search today is certainly way more than that. It's about figuring out where it is where you could feel comfortable and be happy to do work for that type of company. And then if you're doing your own thing, I think that's just incredible. And I think so incredibly difficult to kind of be figuring out everything, right? Because when you have a job, you have specific roles, but when you're doing your own thing, you're doing everything, right? And so I think talk to people is, you know, I think my main piece of advice, like go on LinkedIn, type in different types of positions or different types of companies and shoot them a LinkedIn note and just say, hey, I'm a student, I'm interested in X, Y, and Z, like would love to chat for 10 minutes. And that's it. It just has to be, it doesn't have to be super long. And quite frankly, it probably will go longer because of, you know, you're on this call. So I'm sure, you know, you're super engaged in doing the next thing. And so just have those conversations because, you know, you don't know if you don't talk to someone, you also don't know what opportunities that can unfold. So perhaps it is a freelance gig or, you know, it's a connection with somebody who, you know, might have content to share and, you know, you could cross promote or, you know, just kind of be open to everything and all ideas. And I think that, you know, even if you don't actively act on those things, it's just giving you, you know, more things to reflect on as you go through life.
This question is pretty much related to the last one, but what unique skills do you see people bringing to the table in this brand and marketing research field, and how can students cultivate these skills?
Yeah, it's your mind. It's how you think. It's your opinion on things. And I think the most important thing to remember is that your opinion counts. It matters. And that's the case. You know, when you come into a role, they're hiring you for what you think about and how you present those ideas and how that will better affect who those people are as a company. So I think stay informed and, you know, within your field for certain, because that's obviously very important. And there's so many resources out there, even on social media. I had your apps, you can limit the amount of time you spend, but particularly as a freelancer, there's just so much very valuable information that's out there. That's not just like, you know, normal, like wasting your time sort of scrolling. And so I've taken those limits away because I'm like, wait, this is a really valuable source. So I think don't discredit. I mean, certainly, you know, do your homework, make sure it's accurate, but just be open to all of that information, because the more you know, the better off you'll be, because you could just speak to a ton of things. Like, I think the most valuable part of business conversations are those first 5 to 10 minutes in the room when you're not actually talking about the work. You're talking about, you know, what people are passionate about, what they're interested in. And I think that just takes things like really, really far in terms of, you know, okay, well, this person isn't just a, you know, a one-stop show. It's the whole package. And so keeping informed, I think, is the most important, both inside and outside of the category. I have so many senior bosses who are partner level and above. And anytime in the office, when we're in the office, when I would go over to them, like, most of the time they were reading, and they were on, like, either not books sometimes, but newspapers, or on their phone, just scrolling through articles, or like on their computer, just with podcasts or blogs, and just opening up their mind. And it's really apparent in terms of how they talk in meetings, and talk about anything. And I think that's like, be able to talk about anything, like, but, you know, be educated about it, but also be open to other people's opinions, and be open to changing your opinion. And I think that's how you grow and make it to that next step.
Jeanette, if you could do everything all over again while you were at Manhattanville, would you do anything differently or change anything?
Yeah, it's so interesting. I don't know. I don't think that I would. I think that I did take advantage of everything pretty early on. Maybe I would talk to more people. I feel like, I mean, I did, but I feel like maybe I would go out of my way just a little bit more in terms of, you know, really understanding or just having those discussions. Like I said, you know, the people sitting on the quad or in the library, just, you know, I feel like I was very goal focused, and when whatever that goal was, I did my due diligence and kind of moved on from it as a kind of check off the list, which was just sort of like, you know, my to do, you know, your notebook, your to do list type of thing. So maybe I would have done that. But I think I took a variety of different classes, like in all sorts of disciplines. Like, I even took a physics class. I was like, let's just do it. Let's just think differently. And so, you know, by nature of resonance life, I definitely had a lot of conversations with different resonance people who were young or older than me, who I wouldn't have crossed paths with in class. You know, with the programming that we had done, I think a lot of it was really diverse in terms of, you know, was it educational? Was it social? Was it, what else was it? And so I don't know. I don't think so, but it's hard because with all the experience that you have now in terms of, you know, the different ways of the world, you know, just being more open-minded, just, I don't know. I think it's hard to say looking backwards because, you know, hindsight is always 20/20, but as long as, you know, you're in the moment, I think that's what matters. I had given a presentation in Res Life, and I don't remember actually what the topic was about, but I had figured it out in terms of what is tuition at Manhattanville full, if you didn't have any scholarships or anything, like, what is that price? Because everybody's paying that in some way, shape, or form. And so we divided it. Basically, it was like a couple $100 per day. Like, every time you left your dorm room, or, you know, if you are a commuter, every time you come onto campus, if you actually had to take out of your pocket however many $100 it was, as it was divided across the days, like, what would you do to make that day worth it? You know, and I think that that is something to kind of think about in the moment, because, yeah, I now have, so it's been, what, 8 years since I've graduated. Mm-hmm. I think that looking back, I think to say I would have done things differently, I probably wouldn't have been super realistic because I didn't have that growth and experience. But I think if you're living each day in terms of, okay, how can I max out what I'm doing today? And whether that's, you know, maxing out something that's for you internally, or if it's helping somebody else, or whatever that might be, I think that's certainly valuable experience. And it's just going to help you as you move forward. And then you can, I think, if you're lucky enough to look back and reflect and, you know, say like, okay, well, that helped me figure out what I'm doing today. And maybe I would have done it a little differently then, but the fact that I did it that way helped me to make this decision now. And I think that whole path is, you know, really important.
And then my question is, are there any resources, books, podcasts? I know you mentioned the importance of reading a lot and listening to podcasts. Are there any specific ones that you would recommend students look at that are interested in your field?
I mean, there's so much out there, and I think, you know, you have to, you know, sort of do what speaks to you. I really do like Malcolm Gladwell's podcast because I think he just knows so much about so much. And so his podcast is called Revisionist History. And so it talks about things that are often overlooked in history or underlooked. And he brings light to them and has these really great discussions. It's thoroughly researched. He's super engaging to listen to. And they're pretty short. I think there's four seasons right now. And so I really enjoy that. Malcolm Gladwell is obviously a very big name in, you know, marketing and anthropological thinking. And so I think that that's a pretty good resource. But, you know, I would just sign up for stuff and then see what content comes in. And if it's not something that's igniting you, that's okay. But, you know, move on and find something else. And I think that's something that's really unique about this time period is that, you know, everybody's sort of watching and listening to something else. Like, when you think and you, like, I reflect back with my grammar school friends, like, everybody was watching the exact same thing. Like, we all know the references. Like, it's this really big piece of nostalgia, which is really fun. But it's because there was nothing else out there. And now, you know, you could talk to 100 different people and have nobody watching or listening or reading the same thing. And so, and I think that's great and why you should be talking to different people. But I think if there was one thing I would recommend, it would be to listen to his podcast because it's also by topic. And so you can sort of pick something that sounds like it might be interesting to you, but you'll probably find that they roll into each other. You'll just listen and listen and listen. So I think that would be it. But I think, like, you know, share things and, you know, see what other people are doing. And, you know, that's how I learn about a lot of stuff. And I think I fall into the trap of thinking that if you take something on, you have to fall into this like big commitment and like watch the whole thing or do the whole thing. And I think it's part of the, like, don't be afraid to take risk. Like, if it's not serving you, or it's like, okay, like, great, like, now there's something else I want to dedicate my time to, like, don't be afraid to push something off to the side in light of something new.
Absolutely. Yeah. And it was pretty cool to hear some insights from you as well for myself. I actually just got my master's in marketing communication management. So I definitely think the branding side of things is really cool and interesting. We're always trying to brainstorm ways to develop our personal brand in CCD. And so far, you know, we're seeing that really go in a great direction. But yeah, it was great to hear some of your insights.
Thank you so much, Jeanette. It was nice seeing you too.
Yes, definitely. I wish I could have been in person, but next time.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yes, for sure. Have a great weekend. Thank you so much.
Great summer. Bye.